Good evening, University of Zambia. Welcome to this sensational presentation of the presidential debates for the year 2014. We are proud to be here, and we know that in the next 90 minutes, we're going to have one person that's going to have an upper hand in these elections, and that might just turn around this particular race for the first position in the UNZASU presidential elections. Today, we're going to listen to intellectual reason. We're going to listen as 10 different people with 10 different backgrounds deliberate to make sure that you make the right decision and elect one person who you feel will better this institution in the next 365 days. Thank you so much for being with us. Before we get straight into it, we're going to invite the people that are organizing this debate to give us a few remarks, then we're going to get underway with this particular presentation of the debate. I'm going to call upon Mr. Oliver Muntali, who is from the UNZASU Electoral Commission. Please, let's welcome him as he gives us a few remarks before we get straight into that debate.
Good evening. Good evening. Okay, thank you everyone for coming. To the Deputy Dean of Students, we recognize your presence. Deans of different schools, associations, and would also like to thank ZNBC for taking this opportunity to recognize this important day for the UNZA student. But most importantly, I would like to congratulate the presidential candidates because it is your day. We as Electoral Commission will also still want to thank the presidential candidates for having abided by the rules that we set. We have had no problem with the presidential candidates thus far, and would also like to encourage them to continue abiding by the electoral rules that we have set forth. Because this is simply a roadmap, and the final day is on the 25th. And just to give a short roadmap of what's going to happen, after ZNBC shoots this show, we are going to air it around campus tomorrow at 20 hours sharp. 20 hours, students, we're going to mount two projectors, one in the sports hall and one at Kafue common room, where you, the students, will be able to see your candidates speak their hearts out. I'd also like to encourage the presidential candidates to utilize the time that they'll be given, because this, you have only one opportunity to prove a point to the UNZA student. So as you walk up to the podium, walk with a spring in your step, a smile on your face, with your head high, because you just have one shot at this. We as the Electoral Commission are more than happy, more than proud to work with our candidates, and we are more than convinced that the candidate that will come from these guys will be picked from God, and all of these people are potential winners. So guys, congratulations for making it this far. All the best. Thank you.
Okay, so there you have it. Those were the opening remarks from the UNZA Institutions Electoral Commission. These are the ones organizing this particular election, and they are working hard to make sure that you, the students, do get a president who matches your decency. Now let's go straight into the next remarks coming to us from the ORU, which is the Operation to Rebuild the University of Zambia. And for this, I'm going to welcome Joyce Zulu. Please, a big hand for Joyce.
Pleasant evening to the Deputy Dean, UNZASU executive members, the chairperson of the Electoral Commission, or protocol observed. On behalf of Operation Rebuilding UNZA, I would like to thank everyone who has worked hard to make this debate a reality. I would also like to welcome everyone who has made it here tonight. As Operation Rebuilding UNZA, our mandate is to ensure that the cry of the student gets heard. We believe that only through a vibrant student body will this institution claim its position as one of the leading institutions in Africa. Once again, we have partnered with the UNZA Electoral Commission in making this debate a reality. The main reason for this is to allow all students to have an in-depth analysis of all these candidates' abilities to articulate issues and in turn show that they can potentially lead their students. It is our sincere hope that all students who watch this debate will make the wise decision to vote, especially those who never vote. We urge each and every one of you to seriously scrutinize the candidates and vote wisely, because UNSA needs you. UNSA needs you to vote. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Joyce. Okay, so that was Joyce representing ORU here at the University of Zambia. So the two bodies have given us the opening remarks. Now it's time for us to get into the presidential debate. And believe me when I tell you that this debate will be an act of war. This debate is not for the faint-hearted, for those that prefer leisure over work, but for those that want to work hard, not just for themselves, but for each and every student who puts on a badge with the tag University of Zambia. Let's get straight into it. My first candidate I'm going to call upon is Edward Mono. Edward, please take your stand. Good evening, Edward. How are you doing?
Good evening, sir.
I'm very fine. Kindly tell me a few things. Number one, are you aware that security here at the university is a very big concern for students?
Yeah, definitely, I'm aware of that.
You are aware of that?
Exactly.
Good. Then tell me why in your manifesto you don't say anything about security, but instead you decide to focus not on security, but on leading a people-driven constitution. Don't you think that as president of UNSASU, your top priority must be students here in the university and not a people-driven constitution?
Okay, if I can take you back to my manifesto.
Sure, I do.
You are with it? Yeah.
Let me look for it. I've got a lot of them. I have it now.
Yeah, you can realize that there is a point where I stressed. I say the project and funding. Then point C. I said on the point C that I will erect a pavement, of which this pavement shall connect the new dining hall and the Kalingaringa gate. And from there, from Kalingaringa to the, from new dining hall to Kalingaringa, I'll put the street lights, okay? Or what led me to say all those things is because I realized that the students who are not accommodated in the University of Zambia and stay in Kalingaringa, they are at a higher risk. If you are aware, I think last term, we had a scandal where one of our female student was raped. So I considered all those things as I was making my manifesto. No wonder I touched that area and I talked something related to security for the students. I think I wrote something concerning that.
I've talked to a few students in the university and they're saying that there's a scandal with corruption, especially when it comes to handing out tenders. I have your manifesto here and you seem pretty good with your mathematics because you've got figures for how much it's going to cost for you to build hostels. You've got exact figures. If you are going to be transparent, don't you think these figures should come after you talk to the people that are going to be offering the tenders?
But to collect you just on the construction of hostels, I didn't allude to anything related to that. I'm pretty sure I said projects, and I didn't say for accommodation I shall fund it. No.
So accommodation is not necessary for you to fund?
No, it's not possible to fund the accommodation from the money that we collect from the students. That's just the true thing.
So what's
we just collect about 740,000 Zambian kwacha, and that money cannot be enough to construct a hostel. No wonder I alluded to that this money that I'll get from the student, it will be used to improve the water supply system, to renovate the lecture theaters, to restock the library, as well as painting the University of Zambia. As you can realize, if you get back to chemistry, you realize that walls that are not painted react with rain acid, you see? So this implies that this institution wouldn't last for so long if it's not painted. Now, for instance, if we can't paint our university, now what's the possibility that we can reconstruct the university? So it's better we preserve it, not to reconstruct it. So those are the things that I stressed in my manifesto, not constructing the accommodation.
Thank you, Edward. Edward, give me a one-word answer, true or false? You say that because Zambia is a Christian nation, your administration will ban having classes over the weekend.
Definitely. We
cannot. I said true or false?
Yeah, I mean, true, we'll ban. That's the thing.
You're going to ban. Yeah. So don't you think it's up to individual students to decide, since they are the Christians, isn't it up to every individual student to decide whether they want to go to class or not, and not up to you as president to make decisions for them?
Okay, it would have been like that if lecturers were not forcing them to attend lectures on Saturday and Sunday. But it's a situation whereby lecturers are telling students that you should come on Saturday or Sunday and attend lectures. It's not the student who chooses that. I'm aware that these students, they are committed to God, and they are aware that it's God who made them possible to come to this university. And they follow the declaration of Zambia as a Christian nation. They complain. As I was trying to build this manifesto, I went through the different rooms. I asked them, are you happy with this, what is transpiring currently? They said, we are not happy, but we have no option. If we don't follow what the lecturer says, some they threaten us that you will not sit for an exam. Some they say this and this and so forth. So I said, this thing should come to an end.
What is going to be your priority as UNZASU president? What is going to be your priority?
In terms of what?
You're asking me, I'm asking you, what's going to be your priority? In terms of everything, what's your priority? Number one, you are sworn into office. Number one, what's your priority? The thing at the top of your agenda.
Okay, on 26th, when I'll be elected as the UNZASU president, the first thing I shall make sure is I'll make sure that the government under the Ministry of Home Affairs should realize one thing, that this university has people who have disabilities and has people who are asthmatic. So whenever there is a demonstration, for that case, at the University of Zambia, we have peaceful demonstrations, which are later made a riot by police officers. But I shall make sure that the police officers shouldn't penetrate into the University of Zambia premises, because the University of Zambia premises has people with different disabilities, of which if these people are exposed to toxic gases like the CNS for the tear gas, they can have body health, of course. That's what we are aware, all of us. We are aware that tear gas, CS, it damages the lungs, and it damages the epithelium, that's the top part of the eye. And this may be one of the reasons why the clinic of the eye clinic today is receiving a number of patients who are suffering eye problems. So now, all these things should come to an end. And that's why Edward has come in the union to say, let's end this once and for all.
Thank you very much. Please take a seat. Thank you very much. So that was our first presidential candidate, Edward Mono. Do you feel that his priority is your priority, or do you feel otherwise? Let's now turn our attention to our next candidate, and that is Felix Mbewe. Felix, please take your stand. Felix is absent. Tough luck for him. Let's now turn our attention to our next candidate. I'm going to call upon Mr. David Mulaya, DVD. Mr. President, how are you feeling tonight?
Very well, thank you.
Very well, thank you. Your priority for UNZA students?
The library and good provision of information to the students.
The library, just the library.
I have a policy in my manifesto called the policy to restock the library. And this policy is going to make sure that UNZASU starts to purchase not less than 30 textbooks every month for any randomly selected department. That is agreed upon with my union.
The one thing that I get from your manifesto is the fact that you want the government to be able to increase the BC. Is that true?
Very true.
How do you intend to do that?
As a students' union, we are people who represent the students and champion their interest within this institution, even outside. So this gives us a leeway to go outside and bargain with management, with government, and make sure that, you know, they look at us in a more positive way, because as it is right now, the economy is very bad, and the high cost of living is really eating up the students, and that's the reason we want to make sure that when we go to them, they increase our meal allowances.
Thank you very much. And then going back to your manifesto again, you do highlight the fact that the previous UNZASU administration, the only thing they did in regards to accommodation and project allowances was that they proposed. The only thing they did is propose. They were in office for 1 year. They just proposed. You are going to be in office for 1 year as well. Are you just going to propose? And what is it that made the previous administration fail that you, David, feel are going to succeed? And how are you going to do it?
As a reasonable president, as you can see from my motto, leadership comes with responsibility. What we know is that we have the responsibility to make sure that in as much as we push for these better facilities and for these, better meal allowances, we have a responsibility to protect the students. So as I'm going to be president, I'm going to make sure that we sit down, because these guys just made a proposal and government told them that they're looking into it. So as intellectuals, we had to pull
back. So if government told them they're looking into it, what guarantee do you have that government is going to give you a different response?
The time is overdue. The time we gave them to look into this matter is overdue. So this time around, we would want to see a proactive approach, a practical approach that is going to make sure that these allowances are increased during this time around.
Thank you very much. Let's go to something else. Every presidential candidate is talking about the issue of security. I'm going to put out lights. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. They're focusing on security outside the institution. What's your plan for security within the student hostels? Because students have the laptop stolen, phone stolen, and other personal items stolen. So what's your plan for security within the hostels?
Within the hostels, there was security some time back within the hostels, but due to the problem that actually students had complained that the people who got these premises were the ones who would steal. So this time around, we'd want to make sure we go back to management and tell them there's increased theft within these hostels. We can't continue staying like this. If students are going to be subjected to such high theft, then what are we, ensuring as an institution, making sure that students, okay, let me go back to the point of security. Just a hiccup. Security is very important for the students within these premises, and I'm going to make sure that we revisit the policy of security and make sure that the guards who are within these premises also guard the hostels of the students. And like that was a suggestion that we're going to come up with a security wing that is going to involve students and make sure that these students are going to go within these hostels and make sure that everything is safe and all the doors are locked.
There are 10 presidential candidates here. Why you?
The reason I should be UNZASU president on the 26th is I'm one person who's very determined. I'm a liberal and a radical. So I know how to synchronize these two, and that makes me a good leader.
Thank you, Mr. President. Okay, so that was our candidate number two. The main idea behind this is for each and every one of them to stand out as different from the rest of the other 10. If they are the same, what's the point of an election? Let's find out if our next candidate is different. She is the only presidential candidate in this race. Please welcome Praxidas Mubanga. It's a good evening. How is it for you?
It's great. I don't know about you, Swilanji.
Mine is wonderful. Let me get to one thing that caught me in your manifesto. Yes or no, in your administration, are we going to have vivas?
If it's necessary, I would say yes.
Okay, let me tell you why you're wrong. You are saying that you're going to have a mitigation plan for vivas, meaning you foresee vivas coming, and vivas will come about because you, as a union president, have failed to dialogue with the administration. And then the other thing you want to do is spend money on hiring lawyers to bail out students who are arrested. Who's going to be paying for those lawyers?
Okay, firstly, as regards the issue of demonstrations, I believe people can only demonstrate where needs be. For example, if as a union you try to dialogue and it fails, the next step that you take is probably a possible demonstration. But then the issue of the mitigation plan comes in to say, instead of having an issue where you take students to court, why don't we plan for all events in advance? So the issue of UNSA having a lawyer, there's an article in the UNSASU constitution, that's Article 16. It stipulates that the UNSASU, the union itself, should have a reputable lawyer. So there is no need for us as students to actually seek or search for lawyers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Now, my next question is about your manifesto. You are saying that government must increase allowances for all students and that is not up for negotiation. So how is government going to increase those allowances if you don't negotiate?
Okay, with regards to the issue of government, the government should understand one fact, that it is the one that's imposing the high economic demands on the citizens of Zambia, of which those citizens of Zambia do not exclude the students of the University of Zambia. Let me give an example to say you have accommodation allowance for those who are on 100% BC. at 1,100 kwacha. Then you find that the income for the lowest, or let me say the amount to be paid for the lowest kwati, who is a female kwati, is probably 1,000 per term. So what sense does it make that they should give you an amount for three terms, and then they give you 1,100? To me, it definitely is pathetic. So the government has to increase the allowances, because they are the ones that are putting this demand on us as students. So there is no need for us to negotiate. That is a demand.
Your priorities, President. Your priority as president?
If I had to summarize my priority, it would be transparency and opportunity. That's all.
Transparency and opportunity?
Yes.
So according to you, transparency and opportunity is going to increase student accommodation, it's going to solve the problem. Transparency and opportunity is going to solve the issue of security. Transparency and opportunity is going to solve the issue of students getting raped. Transparency and opportunity. That's it.
Yes, because when you look at the issue of transparency, with regards to transparency, you find that you have to be transparent in the way you award contracts, in the way you make decisions. And if you're going to make decisions with the students, it simply means that they are going to be involved in every activity and they are going to benefit, because no corruption will be taking place in any area. If you have leaders who are corrupt, it means that other areas such as sanitation, such as security, will also be compromised. So transparency acts like a parent to every other unit in the institution.
Thank you. My last question to you. My last question to you. You want medicine to be there at Unza Clinic all the time. That's according to your manifesto, by the way, all the time. Even government, the Ministry of Health, is facing a challenge providing medicine to clinics and hospitals around the country. What makes you think it's going to be just easy for you to have medicine at Unza Clinic all the time when you want it?
The Unza Clinic should firstly understand that it gets 100 kwacha from each student every year with the promise that medicine should be there. Let's give an instance where I'm a student who is diabetic. I will need glamide. Then my glamide is done and I want medicine. They won't have to tell me that I have to go around and search for medicine when I actually paid money for that. So it is the responsibility of the Unza Clinic to ensure that all medicines for all students are made available for the students within a stipulated time. So there is no need for us to put the blame on government. If the clinic does not have medicine, it's better that it informs students so that they have a way out in which they'll seek those medicines.
Thank you, Madam President. Okay, so this election truly is gender sensitive, and we hope that at the end of it, sex will not matter, male or female. At the end of the day, it's up to each and every student from the University of Zambia to make the decision on who they feel deserves to be their leader. Let's go to our next candidate. Please, now I'm going to call upon Maseka Chula.
So, Ilanj.
Good evening, Mr. President.
Good evening, how are you?
I'm very fine, never felt so alive. Tell me one thing. The question I've been asking every candidate, what is your priority?
My priority is BC increment. I think it comes with, it is a package that encompasses everything that we need as students. First, it accounts for our meal allowances, there's book allowance in there, and there's also other incentives.
Okay, so the BC is going to increase overnight, what's your plan? How do you intend to make sure that BC is increased ultimately? What's your plan?
Okay, firstly, you have to realize one thing. Our job as a union is more like the job of an attorney. Okay, and as an attorney, when a student present a case before you, you have to fight a good fight. So basically what happens when you present your case is the client is going to sit back, and as an attorney, you're going to fight for it in court. So the promise I would like to make to University of Zambia students today is that I will be that attorney who fight a good case, and how I'm going to fight that good case really is simple, because it all depends on the figures that we're going to present. It all depends on the evidence that we're going to present.
Students in the university are saying it's the same old story just being told by different mouths. Same old story, just being told by different mouths. You're not the first person to stand for president. Others stood and they failed. Maybe others even had a better chance of achieving those things, but they failed. And then here you come, Messiah. Within 365 days, are people going to be smiling out of the university?
That's why we are calling it the black and white difference. Because we realize that the frustrations and disappointments of students have accumulated over time. We want to make a difference. The agenda which we have for the students is packed up in what we are calling the black and white difference. Meaning we want the difference between what has been transpiring in the previous administrations with our administrations to be black and white. So it's a guarantee which I'm giving to students today that we will make an exception. And mind you, Suwilanji, much as consistent a situation can be, but there's always an exception, and that exception has come. And that exception is the Maseka administration.
Black,
and white.
And white difference.
Sure.
I love it. Now tell me one thing. What is a black and white difference for solutions that face UNSA students? Give us a black and white plan that I can see and say January, February, that is going to work out like that. Give us a clear roadmap, black and white difference. Something that people didn't see in the past because it was black, now it's white, they should see it. What's a black and white plan towards a successful UNSA? So a black and white plan that I can see and I'll believe, and not just a dream written on a manifesto.
Okay, you know, how the previous administration was thinking, I could never understand. And I would take on a totally different leadership approach from the leadership approach they took. Because if you look at the issue at hand, the BC increment proposal, what they did was just submit a proposal. Okay, which I don't think they backed it up with any effort whatsoever. But the guarantee which I would like to give you today and the University of Zambia students is that we are going to defend that case. We are going to present that proposal, but we are going to back it up with a lot of effort to make sure that this proposal goes through and will be accepted.
Thank you, Mr. President. You're complaining about time. What do you want to say that would make someone change their mind? Okay, so that was the audacity of hope. He's promising a black and white difference. You can tell from his suit, eh? Black and white, black and white, black and white. Okay, so this is still the UNSASU presidential debate right here at the University of Zambia. Let's now turn our attention to our next candidate. Please welcome Golden Museteka. Good evening, Mr. President.
Good evening, Suwilanji.
Evening is fine. The golden change.
Yes.
Is it golden change just because your name is golden, or there's really going to be a golden change?
Suwilanji, last time I took an English lesson was grade 12 high school. I'm studying agricultural sciences here. The golden change is a verb, the name golden. And in my name, that's a noun. I'd like to tell you something and explain this to the student. The golden change is a vision that I have for my house, my level, the institution, the country, and that the world at large. It's going to come with responsibility, maturity, transparency, and rekindle our integrity for this reputable institution, the Golden Change.
Let's get to your manifesto. The one thing that you want, eh? Give me a true or false, one word. You want to innovate the lecture rooms at this university to match international standard.
Yes, Suwilanji.
Okay, that is very good, eh? I hope it works. Now, from 2000, 2001, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13,